This is the motto of the show, Hour of the Truth. Rome never changes. They used to call us heretics and sent the Inquisition to kill us. Today they call us terrorists and send on their crusades. Times and methods may have changed, but goal still stays the same. Extirpate the remnant of the true Word of God, Bible-believing people who uphold the truths in Jesus Christ's name.
Suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be lulled by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Hello, this is Jörg Glissmer once again from YouTube channel Joggler66 with another episode on Hour of the Truth. We have today Thursday, the 3rd of December 2015, our regular broadcast day, but a completely new broadcast, I can assure you. Today I have with me one of my most, how do you say that? I don't want to use the wrong word. most admired persons on the internet that I listen to very, very frequently, a brother in Christ that I have learned so much of. It's incredible. A brother in Christ who allows me every week to have at least 2 hours Bible study with him, from which I learn even more, because you all know that I have never read my Bible completely. And with my guest on here, I'll do it at least these 2 hours every Sabbath that we do. But he has been very, very busy the latest few months, and I don't want to withhold his name any longer. You probably guessed it by his laughing in the background. Anyway, it is Tom Fress from Inquisition Update, who devoted the last, let's say, a little bit more than half year on Inquisition Update, where he was busy on First Amendment Radio, reading every day, 1 hour, a book that is called The Global Vatican. A title that speaks to a many people and that doesn't speak to a many people either. So some people it speaks to, some people it doesn't. I can tell you when you read it, it speaks to you. And you will probably understand it very, very well. There is a brother in Christ I once knew who said that if you follow the readings that Tom Fress does on the Global Vatican, you will get a master's degree in history afterwards. And I have to agree a little bit on that. So the intention today on our program is to have a conversation with Tom Fress, where he explains a little bit and asks and answers a little bit of my questions that I want to ask him about the book, The Global Vatican, that was written by a knight of Malta, Francis Rooney. He was an ambassador to the United from the United States to the Holy See between the years 2005 and 2008. Now, with no further ado, welcome to the broadcast, Tom. Introduce yourself to my listeners and thank you very much for being on here today and sharing your experience on that book with us.
Yes, thank you, Jörg, and good evening to you and your listeners. It's my pleasure and my privilege and my blessing to be here and to reveal what is disclosed in this book, the startling disclosure in this book entitled The Global Vatican by a former U.S. ambassador to the Holy See, Francis Rooney. Not only the disclosure, but the boast that the Vatican controls foreign and domestic policy for the United States. That's foreign and domestic policy for the United States. And policy is just another word for law. It controls foreign, the United States' foreign relations with other nations, and it also is heavily influenced in the civil laws of our land. Now, before I even go any further, I have highly recommended this book for people to read so that they might know who is truly at the head of this so-called New World Order, which is not new at all, but which is simply the modern reestablishment of that old world order that was headed up by the papacy. That old world order, when the papacy controlled the governments of the world, or rather the governments of Europe, and was overthrown by the Protestant Reformation. That very order of things that existed in the times that we in history buffs know as the Dark Ages is simply being reborn. And it is the governments of the world who are helping to bring it about. A global government headed up by the self-styled Vicar of Christ, the one who has always claimed divine right to rule the world and to rule over the kings of the earth. The very one who did just that during the Dark Ages. Now, we've been led to believe in the mainstream and the alternative medias that, everyone is discussed as having been part of this new global government that's coming about. The Bilderbergers, the Trilateral Commission, the Council on Foreign Relations, you name it, the Club of Rome, everyone has talked about these things as being contributors to this new world order. But what is never recognized and what is never discussed is their relationship to the papacy. It is the agenda of the papacy that is being promoted by all of these groups. It is the papacy that is slated to become the global governor of the world. And it's prophesied even in our scriptures. Revelation chapter 17 in the Bible describes this woman, this harlot. And we know it's a convention in the Bible. It's a typical convention used regularly throughout the Bible that any church is regarded in the female sense. We know the Bible uses the convention to describe Bible-believing Christians, those of the faith of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, those who believe in Jesus as the Messiah. We are called the bride of Christ. We also know that Israel, the nation-state of Israel that existed under God's jurisdiction that is in the Bible, as long as they obeyed God and served God righteously, God referred to them as his spouse or as a chaste virgin. On the other hand, anytime Israel betrayed Christ, betrayed God, and began to bow down and worship men and images and idols and such like, she was regarded as a whore, having betrayed her spouse, and had gone a-whoring after other gods. Likewise, in Revelation chapter 17 is described a whore. And it's for us to let the Bible interpret itself and come to the right conclusion that this whore can represent only one thing, and that is a church which professes Christ but goes a-whoring after other gods. And there's also described beneath her a beast, a scarlet-colored beast. And we know that scarlet is the color of sin. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Right? This scarlet-colored beast is a sinful beast, and it carries this woman. This woman doesn't walk on her own. She's carried by a beast. Now, that beasts are described in the Bible, defined in the Bible, by the prophet Daniel. Daniel used images of beasts to describe the pagan nations of the world that ruled from the time of King Nebuchadnezzar all the way to the present. Four beasts he describes. The first representing the Babylonian Empire. The second beast he described representing the Grecian Empire. The third beast that he described represents, or rather, the Persian Empire. Then the third beast he describes represents the Grecian Empire, the Greek Empire, and then the fourth and final empire upon the earth was an iron empire, and it was an indescript beast. In other words, it couldn't be described as anything earthly. It was the worst beast of all, and it trampled the truth with the feet of it.
Can I ask a question here?
Yes.
Yeah. What you are just saying, I just opened Revelation chapter 13 in my King James mm-hmm. Bible. And what I found so interesting while you were reading the book, The Global Vatican, was that how it was absolutely for everybody to see with eyes to see and ears to hear when they listened to you and read that book, how the Roman Catholic Church can be traced back first and for all to Greece.
Yeah.
Because when we read the second verse of Revelation 13, quote, "And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard." Yeah. A leopard, that was the Grecian Empire.
That was used to describe the Grecian Empire. That's
and
true.
We know from our studies, the philosophical doctor of the Roman Catholic Church, Thomas Aquinas, who lived in the 13th century, and his writings are today, and that's why I want to say that, because that brings us a little bit to 2015, where this year we had the Antichrist visiting America. Mm-hmm. The teachings of Thomas Aquinas, who was the so-called theosophical doctor of the Roman Catholic Church in the 13th century, everything that he taught is picked up today by Pope Francis, the Antichrist yeah. today. Yeah. And everything that Thomas Aquinas wrote was based on the writings of Socrates, yeah. Plato, and help me, the third one,
I think I have the same problem. But
I always leave out the third one.
The point is well made. The Roman Catholic Church carries the philosophy of all those former beasts.
Yeah.
Roman Catholicism is essentially the eclectic mix
of
all the
point.
Errors of those previous kingdoms, from Babylon through Persia through... Yeah. Through Greece and it has become the storehouse.
Another interesting point here is, Tom, there is a saying, a leopard doesn't change its spots.
No, indeed.
Well, the Roman Catholic Church never changes, right?
Right.
From the inception of the Roman Catholic Church through all the Dark Ages and the confirmation of the Counter-Reformation and the Council of Trent and the confirmation of the Council of Trent 400 years later with Vatican II between 1962 and 1965,
yeah.
with unleashing the final ecumenical movement on the evangelic bellies, or how do you call them? I always have to laugh when you say that. I love that quote, that evangelic bellies. And now with this jubilee year that Pope Francis announced, 50 years after the closing of Vatican II, the final ultimatum, when we look back at that history of the last 2,000 years, we can see that the Roman Catholic Church never changed, like a leopard never changed its spot. And from there, I found it interesting to make this little journey into Revelation, when John sees in this vision, the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, that, as we know, was the Medo-Persian Empire before them, and his mouth was the mouth of a lion, and that is associated with Babylon.
Yes.
And the dragon, which is the serpent, which is Satan, gave him his power and his seat and great authority.
Yeah.
So we have in this last beast part of Babylon, part of Medo-Persia, part of Greece, and even the most part, I think, part of Greece, because it says, the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard. So the most likeness that it had was unto a leopard. And the leopard stands for Socrates, Plato, and shoot, I still can't get the third one. I have to write that down sometimes. But anyway, you know what I mean.
Yes,
and
I do.
The Grecian Empire and all these philosophers, they stand for one thing, and that is the teaching of man.
Yeah.
That is the teaching of what we have today in the New Age, of course.
Yeah.
I just wanted to refer to this Revelation chapter 13, to this beast, when we go into the Vatican, because I think that's maybe something new for some of our listeners here.
Certainly. But
please continue.
Well, and to continue my discussion about Revelation 17, it's a dead ringer for the Roman Catholic Church and the governments of the world that carried her. The harlot is described as the Roman Catholic Church. And the beast that carries it are the kingdoms of the earth. Daniel used beast to describe the kingdoms of the earth. And when we see this beast in Revelation chapter 17, it has to represent that fourth and final beast upon the earth, Rome, that fourth and final empire. There is no discussion in the Bible about a fifth, only four. And no historian would disagree that it's talking about the four empires from Babylon to Medo-Persia to Greece, and then finally, Rome. So what we conclude from that, what we must conclude from that, without equivocation, since Daniel didn't describe a fourth, or rather a fifth beast, that this fourth beast, this Roman beast, will exist until the consummation of the age, the return of Christ. And that the fourth and final empire, which we know was established just before Christ, as they say, his first advent, just before the birth of Christ, was already in the world, already a fact of history, the ancient pagan Roman Empire. And this is the very reason why Jesus said these are the last days. Because that fourth and final beast that would rule the world was already in existence, and it made an apparent change, which was no change whatsoever, when the old pagan Roman Empire supposedly fell and was replaced by the quote-unquote Holy Roman Empire, which is the Papal Empire. And it's just a play on words, because the papacy regards itself as the modern-day Caesar, that he still has the power and authority and the divine right of Caesar to rule the world. That's part of the bequest that was received by the papacy by the so-called donation of Constantine. Emperor Constantine was said to have donated to the papacy virtually all of his power. And that is global power as a temporal ruler as well as a spiritual ruler. And so we see the eclectic mix, if carefully observed and examined, we see the eclectic spiritual and temporal consummation in the papacy of all those prior kingdoms. And we must also conclude, if we're going to believe the Bible as God's inerrant word of God, that that fourth and final beast is, since Christ has not yet returned, it's still in power. It has never really, truly died. Now, there was described in the Bible a time when this beast received a mortal wound, but it says that the mortal wound was healed. The death of that beast came, the death of the Roman Empire, the Papal Empire, came at the Protestant Reformation, when the Bible was first read by the people in their own language. No longer were they held to believe forcibly what the papacy taught, what the Roman Catholic Church taught. See, prior to the Protestant Reformation, people were forbidden to read the Bible. If you got caught reading the Bible or had a copy of the scriptures, at first they would remove your Bible from your possession and burn it. And as time went on and it became apparent that burning Bibles was never going to silence the word of Almighty God, they began to burn Bible readers. Not just Bibles, but Bible readers. To the tunes of hundreds of thousands of people died for their defense of the scriptures. Having read it for the first time in their own language, they came to the irrevocable conclusion that there's no other entity in world history that better fulfills the description of the man of sin or the son of perdition or the Antichrist of the Bible than the papacy. And that was the very foundation of the Protestant Reformation. First, the Bible and Christ, God's word, and then the obvious revelation that is found in it. That we should never be confused or mistaken about who the Antichrist is, no more than we should be confused or uncertain about who Jesus Christ was. And they all came to the unanimous conclusion that the papacy is, was, and always will be the Antichrist of the Bible. And here we have this new world order that is virtually identical with the old world order, now being promoted once again by all the kings of the earth and all the great think tanks of society, which I have just mentioned. But somehow, the papacy has still remained anonymous in all of this. The governments don't talk about the papacy being the head of it. The United Nations doesn't talk about the papacy being the head of it. The Council on Foreign Relations, the Bilderbergs, the Club of Rome even. But it's as plain as the nose on your face. Now, as careful as Rome has been to protect herself from being described as the very leader of this New World Order, here we have a book written by a former U.S. ambassador to the Holy See, Francis Rooney, who has as much as admitted, not just admitted, but boasted that the papacy is vitally critical to the foreign and domestic policy, not only of the United States, but of the UN, the European Union, and all of the kingdoms of the earth. And people, I am admonished, if they don't have any historical understanding of what the papacy has done and what it represents in the world in history, they're bound to read this book and misunderstand what it's saying. That's why I spend such a great deal of time and effort in studying the history of the Roman Catholic Church and verifying for myself that it has indeed fulfilled every prophecy in the Bible regarding the Antichrist. And its identity as the Antichrist cannot be argued, cannot be refuted. There's no other candidate for this person, this office, as the papacy. And just as surely as we can believe that Jesus is our Messiah, because of the biblical descriptions of even his crucifixion and the very words that he would say, the miracles that he would do, the grace that he would bestow on his people, we can be just as sure that the same prophecies which identify the Antichrist identify no one else but the papacy. You know, I've always asked Christians, Bible-believing, Bible-reading Christians. It's amazing to me that the Jews could have missed Christ.
Yeah,
but how is it that they knew not the time of their visitation when Jesus so perfectly fulfilled the prophecies of the Old Testament regarding Messiah?
Well, first and for all, there's the Talmudic curse that we know of.
Yes.
That the Pharisees at that time, the rabbis, so meaning the clergy of the Jewish people in that time, were laying a Talmudic curse on the book of Daniel, where in Daniel chapter 9 it is very clearly written when Messiah will come.
Yes.
And this Talmudic curse is something we can, I can maybe look up a little bit later and tell you, but I just wanted to make a little note from a few minutes ago. You were speaking about the Pope is actually the Caesar, like he was in the old pagan Roman Empire. Mm-hmm. And when I followed your book reading, I was very much interested when you spoke about Pio Nino, one of the most vicious popes we've ever had.
Yeah.
As far as I remember, he was the one who was longest in office, I think, more than 30 years.
Yeah.
And he was in office at a very, very, very interesting time, because in the time of his reign, the Vatican lost the Papal States to the Kingdom of Italy in 1870. At the same time, the Pope was declared infallible. So this wound that was afflicted once again, because if you ask me, there are three wounds. The first wound was the Reformation. The second wound was General Berthier taking captive the Pope in 1798, ending the 1260-year reign of the Roman Catholic Church, and the third strike was when the Vatican was taking away all his power, of this power that he allegedly had, because we know of the false Isidorian decretals and the false donation of Constantine, but he claims that he has that right because of that, and he lost all the Papal States in 1870. And at that time, Pope Pius IX, or Pio Nino, as he is also called, was reigning. And he had also a paper called a Discorsi, and you are, of course, very familiar with that quote that I'm going to read right now, because in that, Pope Pio Nino said, quote, "The Caesar who now addresses you, and to whom alone are obedience and fidelity due," unquote.
Exactly.
This is just 140, 150 years from now. And today, nobody, as you said, not the CFR, not the Club of Rome, the Trilateral Commission, the Council of 300, the, I don't know, name them all, the so-called quote-unquote elites, no one refers to the Caesar anymore. And surely no one refers to the connection that the Caesar has with Pontifex Maximus, which is the official title, the bridge builder of the Antichrist.
Yeah,
I just wanted to mention this this quote from Pio Nino, because I found that very interesting. And another interesting thing, and that's maybe something we can do in a future broadcast, Tom, to go into, is this damnable paper that Pope Pius IX or Pio Nino brought out, condemning all all governments, all man-made governments,
all popular governments. That is, governments of, by, and for the people.
His paper was called, it's on the top of my tongue, I know that.
Quanta Cura was one of them. It was the papal encyclical.
Syllabus of Errors.
Pardon?
The Syllabus
of Errors. Sure, that was published at the same time.
Yeah, that's the one that I wanted to talk about. That's maybe something for in the future to go a little bit through, because I think that what we can read in the Syllabus of Errors, which was written about 1863, 1864, mm-hmm. I think that a lot of what is found in that paper, when we look at the United States of America today, under the NDAA and the Patriot Act, is a lot that we see back in there. We see a mirror in that, don't we?
Yes, indeed. History repeating itself. It's taking on the form and fashion of the old world order. And the reason people don't recognize all this as being what I claim it to be, simply because they don't, they've never been taught what the old world order was, nor who was its head. The churches don't teach it. The schools don't teach it. The government doesn't teach it. It's been forgotten. But it's not hard to learn. And when you learn about the old world order, how it was when the papacy seated and unseated the kings, then every king, no matter what country he reigned in, ruled at the behest of the papacy and with the papacy's permission, is the same one who rules the kings of the earth today. Once you realize how the papacy controlled the kings of the earth in the old world order, it makes it much easier to recognize the papacy's hand in control of the governments of the world today.
Exactly.
Now, I'll continue my thought that I was discussing before.
Yes, please.
Which I didn't finish. I mean, no one could miss. I mean, if he reads his Bible with any conviction at all, in the Psalms and the prophecies, we see Jesus. There's no mistake. There's no way we can be confused. Now, I have a question to ask your listeners. If God made it so perfectly obvious from the scriptures who the Messiah would be when he came, why would he then deal treacherously with us by not making just as evident to us and just as provable to us from the scripture who the Antichrist is, who the counterfeit Christ is, the one who would deceive the whole world? So we have to ask that serious question. God literally made it unmistakable who the Messiah would be, even to the very time that he would enter Jerusalem. 490 years from the going forth of the command to rebuild and restore Jerusalem to the Messiah, the Prince, shall be 7 years, 67 weeks, 62 weeks, and then Messiah would come. All right, 69 weeks, 62 plus 7 equals 69, is 69 weeks of years, 483 years. Then Messiah would come. Now, of that 70-week prophecy, there's only 1 week left. And it says, in the midst of the week, he will cause the sacrifices and oblations to cease. In other words, after the 69th week, which means at the beginning of the 70th, for those who are having trouble with math, Messiah would come. And in the midst of the week, 1 week of years, 1 7-year period, in the midst of that 70th and final week, he, Messiah, would cause the sacrifices and oblations to cease. Now, how did he do that? By becoming the Lamb himself, sacrificed for us all. Okay, that was the midst of the week. That was the midst of the 70th week of Daniel. The last week. Now, why is it the whole world believes in a future 70th week? That's because of the rabbinic curse. It's because of the same curse that has come upon God's church today. The 70th week of Daniel is perfectly and completely fulfilled by Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago. That's why they place the rabbinic curse on the book, on anyone who reads the book of Daniel, because it positively, unmistakably marks the beginning of the 800 and I have trouble doing the math, the 383 years or 483 years. The end of the 483 years would mark the advent of Jesus Christ, the beginning of the last 7 years of that prophecy.
I can.
That's why the rabbis. That's why the rabbis forbid the Jews. That's why they didn't know the time of their visitation. The rabbis forbid the Jews to study and understand the book of Daniel, and particularly Daniel's 70th week, the 9th chapter.
Yeah, I have that rabbinic curse here. I can read it for our listeners
here. Go right ahead.
It is taken from the Talmudic Law, page 978, section 2, line 28. And it can be found in a video from Walter Veit, In the Total Onslaught series, number 6, The Revelation of Jesus Christ, at 1 hour 23 minutes and a few seconds. The rabbinic curse, quote, "May the bones and the hands of the bones of the fingers decay and decompose of him who turns the pages of the book of Daniel to find out the time of Daniel 9:24 through 27, and may his memory rot from off the face of the earth forever." Unquote.
Now that's what the church leaders in Israel were telling the Jews. Stay out of the book of Daniel. If you do, I command the bones of your fingers to rot. Especially if you read the 9th chapter, verse 24 through 27, to discover the precise timing of the coming of Jesus the Messiah. That's why all of Israel did not know the time of their visitation. God left it absolutely impossible for the Jews to miss their Messiah, his coming. The question I ask your listeners is, if God was so precise in his prediction, his declaration that Christ would come at this specific time, so that no man could deny or question if he was the Messiah, but proclaimed that surely this is the Messiah, just like the Roman centurion did after the crucifixion, truly this was the Son of God. All of Israel should have been just as convicted, just as convinced that Jesus was the Messiah. Now, if God went to that much trouble to make sure no one had any excuse to miss Jesus and positively identify him, even by the very acts and words that he would say, why would he leave us in doubt about who it is that's going to deceive the whole world, even if it were possible the very elect? The fact of the matter is, God does not deal treacherously with the people he bled and died to save. He does not want us to be deceived. He never intended for us to be deceived, but we will be deceived. And why? Because we misunderstand the very same prophecies that the Jews did not understand.
Yeah, and that's due to the
and
same
who
spirit.
Who has deceived us about that prophecy? The papacy.
You know, it's due to the same spirit, you know. The spirit of Satan cursed the Talmudic law, the Talmudic of rabbinic curse on the Jews, that they missed the time of their visitation. Yep. And it is the same spirit that works today through the Vatican and through the Pope and, of course, the Jesuits and all their affiliates that cheats the people of knowing who the Antichrist is today. Yeah. God didn't cheat the Jews in that time. God didn't cheat or doesn't cheat us this time. It is another spirit. Mm-hmm. It is just that people receive another spirit and they cannot tell the difference.
That's right. And there's no excuse for us to be deceived. God's given us certain certainty about who the Antichrist is.
Not if we know the scripture, Tom, but that's the problem in the days of today that we have. People do everything but reading their Bible.
Yeah.
And when they read the Bible, they probably take one of the corrupted versions. Mm-hmm. And the problem is that when you have a corrupted version and not the true preserved word of God, then the Bible does not make that much sense. It doesn't even explain itself. But the King James Bible, the authorized version of 1611, which was, by the way, not authorized by any office, but authorized because it was accepted throughout the world after its publication, mm-hmm. that true preserved word of God that we have today, that explains itself. And when you read that Bible, I won't even say cover to cover, but take a book here and take a book there, and you will see that it explains itself. And you will have no trouble, like all the reformers had 500, 600 years ago, had no trouble of identifying who the Antichrist is. God left us with this with this word, with his word, the Bible, because this is our guideline through our life. Without the Bible, we have nothing. We are nothing. We are exactly that what the Antichrist teaches. We are nothing. We are just little spots in some great indefinite universe without the Bible. With the Bible, that gets a whole other notion. And that's why the Bible is persecuted, burned, forbidden, and persecuted all over and all the time since its existence. But please continue, Tom. Sorry.
Well, the Gentile equivalent of those who deceived the Jews, the rabbis, the most revered in Israel, the one whom Jesus himself reviled, the religious leaders of the Jews, has now been inherited by the papacy. The Gentile equivalent of those rabbis is the papacy. And the papacy inherited the same problem that the rabbis inherited, the curse, the rabbinic curse. It is the papacy who has guided the world to misunderstand Daniel's prophecy. Now, here's the problem. The Bible vividly, in full living color, describes who this Antichrist power is, so much so that no one can mistake it. Just as surely as the Bible describes in detail Jesus Christ, our Messiah, so that no one could be misled, it equally and effectively, just as effectively, describes the man of sin, the son of perdition, so that none of God's people have any reason to be deceived. So the onus of Antichrist immediately fell upon the papacy, and even though the scriptures were withheld from the people's hands, it was still the priests who were allowed under supervision to read the scriptures as the best as they had them, which was perverted nonetheless. But historically, throughout the history of the Roman Catholic Church, here one and then another and then another and another, and then even groups of these priests and cardinals and Gentile rabbis would read the scripture and they would say, hey, this is describing our Pope, the Antichrist, the man of sin, the son of perdition of the Bible, is our Pope. And so, you know, they had to be careful who they said this to, because you could lose your head. You'd be burned at the stake for such a comment. But nonetheless, it kept coming up. It kept cropping up. The papacy always had to defend himself against his own cardinals, his own bishops, his own priests. And so even the papacy, carefully tried to conceal the scriptures even from his own priests. And so the papacy, being continually accused of being the Antichrist by his own priests, had to come to his own rescue and develop another school of interpretive thought, of biblical prophecy interpretation, that would exonerate the papacy, so the papacy would never again be under these constant accusations of being the man of sin, the son of perdition. So they came up with, an alternative interpretation of the prophecies, which has come to be regarded in its modern version as preterism. That this man of sin, this deceiver, this destroyer, this beast, was somehow someone in the Grecian Empire, like Alexander the Great, or Antiochus Epiphanes, or even in the pagan Roman Empire, because we know the Bible gives no possibility that it was a Greek. It has to come from the fourth and final kingdom on the earth. It has to be a Roman. That much we can conclude conclusively without argument. The Antichrist power comes from the Roman Empire. And so in response to that argument, a very valid argument given to the papacy from his own priest, no, it has to come from the Roman Empire. So the papacy said, well, then it was Caligula or Nero or one of the wicked pagan Caesars of the Roman Empire. Well, if that satisfied the priest for a while, then we have further discussions that said that he would betray Christ. Well, how could that be if it was a Caesar who reigned before Christ? You see, so the papacy has always been trying to shed away from itself the onus of Antichrist, which to me is proof positive that he is the Antichrist. I mean, if he's not the Antichrist, why does he spend all of his time developing alternative interpretations of Bible prophecy that shed the onus away from himself? He is indeed the Antichrist. Now, for those who don't buy preterism, that it was not Alexander the Great, it was not Nero, it was not Caligula or any of the other depraved Roman emperors, then what other school of prophecy could we come up with that would further shed the onus away from Antichrist and finally silence the priests? Well, they came up with a future tale. They went back to Daniel chapter 9 and verse 27, and they said, well, the he that's spoken of here in Daniel 9:27 is not the Messiah, it's the Antichrist. He will cause the sacrifices and oblations to cease. That the Antichrist will come. He comes in the future, and he will cause the sacrifices and oblations to cease. Trouble is, there were no sacrifices taking place. As a matter of fact, Israel ceased to exist. The temple had been destroyed in 70 AD. There was no longer a nation state of Israel. So in order to make that prophecy fit, the Antichrist, rather than Jesus Christ, whom they reject as the Messiah, that's right, that's right. The papacy rejects Jesus as the Messiah, just like the Jews do. Yes, I know they preach Jesus, but you can't preach Jesus out of one side of your mouth and say that Jesus was not the one who caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease.
Well, according to the Pope, there Jesus failed as the at the cross.
That's right. According to the teaching of John Paul II, it is written in one of his encyclicals that Jesus did not come to be the Messiah, but that he came to show the Christ in every man. And papacy since then have confirmed that that's what the papacy believes.
Pope Francis this year already twice officially said, I think the first time was in the cathedral in New York, and the other time was some days or some weeks ago, he officially said that Jesus failed at the cross.
Yeah.
Yeah. And where they took this deception from, I mean, this is very interesting that you go into Daniel 9, verse 26 and 27 again, but I'd like to go a little bit more into the book, Tom. But
sure.
But before we do that, I would like to read Daniel 9, 26, 27, that we together can make for the listeners very, very sure where the confusion is laid from the Antichrist today.
Yeah.
Listen to verse 26. And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. Of course, here you have to know that after 62 weeks, that was predecessed by 7 weeks already. So we are talking about 69 weeks altogether. Shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. And the end thereof shall be with a flood. And unto the end of the war, desolations are determined. Now, 27. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. Now, Tom, I think this is the most profound thing that we can ever talk about when we
Absolutely.
Speak about Daniel 26, 27.
Absolutely.
After 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, and he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. The next sentence in verse 26 is, and the people of the prince that shall come. So the Roman Catholic Church tries to deceive you with even taking a wrong reference grammatically.
Yeah.
Because it is he that shall confirm the covenant with many. And when they say that he will be the Antichrist in the future, it is not possible because it has he must be the Messiah who is cut off. Because in the second sentence it says, and the people of the prince that shall come and shall destroy. The people of the prince. In verse 27, it does not say and they shall cause the sacrifice and oblations to cease. It says he. He must refer to Messiah, cannot refer to the people of the prince.
Yes. And for those who don't know it, and most don't because they've never been taught, they've only always been taught the error, the error that Rome has promoted among the churches. The prince that came and destroyed the temple in 70 AD was Prince Titus of the Roman 10th Legion. He was a general. But he was more than that. He was the son of the current reigning pope, or the current reigning Caesar at the time, Vespasian. So the prophet Gabriel, when he gave Daniel that prophecy, foresaw that Prince Titus and the people that were with him would come and destroy the temple. And then Rome takes that opportunity to describe the he in verse 27, the very next verse, to be the Antichrist. When it is not, when the standard grammatical reference would be, if it represented anything in verse 26, it would have to represent the people of the prince. The people are the subject of that prior sentence. So now you come to realize that it's not talking about either the people or the prince that shall come, but it's referring to Messiah. He shall cause the sacrifices and oblations to cease in the midst of the week, the final week, the 70th week. And that's just exactly how the New Testament records it. People need to know, when they read the New Testament, they are actually reading the proof that Jesus fulfilled the 70th week of Daniel. It was he who caused the sacrifice and oblations to cease when he gave up his own life as the Lamb of God. And how do we know that he caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease from that point? Not necessarily because the prince that shall come came and destroyed the temple. No, it's even more powerful than that. The Bible records that at the time when Christ gave up the ghost, that the veil of the temple was rent from top to bottom. In other words, God ripped that veil of the temple. Now, you must know, if you know anything about the Jewish law, the Old Testament law, the law of animal sacrifices, that system could not continue with that veil ripped in two. The priest could not enter the Holy of Holies with that veil intact, without that veil being intact, or he would have been killed. So the priest, at the very time when Jesus was hanging on the cross and ready to give up his life, the priest was making sacrifice for all of Israel and ready to take that blood into the Holy of Holies. When that veil was seen to be open, the priest had to turn or be killed. That's the Jewish law. No one dare enter that temple. That's how he caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease. Jesus is the fulfillment of the 70th week of Daniel. The 70th week of Daniel was slated by the angel to being the coming of the Messiah. After 62 weeks, understanding that there were previously 7 weeks were determined, altogether 69 weeks, it says after, you could just as well read that scripture this way. After 69 weeks shall Messiah be cut off. How long after the 69th week? How far into the 70th week? 3.5 years. And we know from the time of the baptism of Jesus in the River Jordan by John the Baptist, exactly 3.5 years later, he gave up the ghost on the cross. But Rome says that's wrong. Do you realize our entire faith depends on that interpretation? If it was not Jesus who caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease, if it was not the Messiah who caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease, precisely at 3.5 years after the beginning of the 70th week of Daniel, Jesus is not our Messiah. And that's exactly what the papacy teaches. The papacy, though it preaches Jesus Christ in every other way, denies Jesus was the Christ. Even by the very title of the Pope, which is the Vicar of Christ, which literally means the replacement of Jesus, they seek to usurp his throne. Even the very title of the papacy literally means Antichrist. That's what Vicar of Christ means. You can go to a dictionary and look up the word vicar and look up the prefix anti, and you get the same definition. Vicar of Christ means replacement of Christ. Did anybody replace Christ? Could anybody replace Christ? If someone would suggest that the Holy Spirit replaced Christ, he would have answered correctly. So who is this man in Rome who calls himself the replacement of the Son of God when that office is held by none other than the Spirit of God himself? He is a blasphemer of the Holy Spirit. The Antichrist, the Vicar of Christ, the papacy, is a blasphemer of the Holy Spirit because by his very title, he claims the office of the Holy Spirit. At the time of the Pentecost, Jesus said, prophesied ahead of time, I must go away, for if I go not away, the Comforter will not come. But if I go away, the Comforter will come, and he will teach you all things. What does the papacy claim? To teach us all things. No spiritual truth can be derived from the Scriptures unless it is spoon-fed to you from the papacy, the official teaching of the Roman Catholic Church. He fulfills so perfectly and so vividly the role of Antichrist in the world, no one could credibly dispute it. And yet the whole world is ignorant of it. The whole world believes that even though it is so precisely described who the Messiah would be, it's equally as precisely described who the Antichrist is of the Bible, and yet everyone in the world is clueless except those who are bringing about this new world order and dare not inform anybody that the Pope is the head of it.
Yeah,
it's just as simple as that.
A very good point. You know, people who are waiting for the 70th week to be fulfilled should understand that when they read the first five books of the New Testament, the Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and finally the Book of the Apostles, it was called that, right? Acts.
Well, the Book of Acts, too.
The Book of Acts. These five books, and especially the first four, the first four books resemble completely the first 3.5 years of the 7-year 70th week.
Yeah.
And the Book of Acts with the apostles, the second half.
Yeah.
Because with the stoning of Stephen, they ended their ministry to the Jews.
Yep.
And the gospel went out to the Gentiles.
Yes.
And that was the end of the 7 years of the 70th week. Of the last 7 years of the 70th week vision that Daniel gave.
Yeah.
So when you are looking to a future Antichrist, then you are looking into time of trouble that lies ahead of you instead of looking back to the time when Jesus preached the kingdom of God on earth.
Yeah.
And there is another thing, another point that I made a few broadcasts ago. When you are looking for a future Antichrist, understand that the Roman Catholic Church today teaches Antichrist is not here. Antichrist will be a future single person in the future that comes.
Mm-hmm.
The Antichrist will be revealed, and then afterwards Christ will come.
Yeah.
That's what the Roman Catholic Church teaches. So when you follow the teachings of man, first the Antichrist will be revealed, and then Christ will be revealed. Whereas if you study the Bible, God tells us from the moment of the creation on that first Christ will come, And then afterwards, Antichrist will be revealed.
Yes.
And that is the teaching of all the other books after Acts in the second in the New Testament, mm-hmm. especially in the book of Thessalonians. As far as I know by heart right now, you can help me there, Tom. You know all the books
second
much better than I do.
Chapter 2. Yeah.
Yes, and in all these books, it is said that when this and this happens, then the little horn, the man of sin, the son of perdition, will be revealed. So the Bible teaches first comes Christ and then comes Antichrist. And the Pope teaches first comes Antichrist and then comes Christ.
Yes.
You see the same methodic thing that they do. The Antichrist, Satan, always twists everything 180 degrees around.
Mm-hmm.
When the Bible says it is that way, Antichrist says, no, it is this way. And they are 180 degrees opposed to each other.
Yeah.
They could not be more far off from each other. So when you believe the teaching of the Roman Catholic Church, you deny that Jesus is come in the flesh, has died on the cross for the forgiveness of your sins and shed his blood for you.
Yeah.
You cannot be saved. You cannot enter the kingdom of Christ if you do believe in a future Antichrist.
There's another thing that we do absentmindedly when we buy this lie, this lie from Rome. And that is not only that Jesus was not the one who caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease, which he did, but that if the Antichrist is future, that exonerates the entire history of the papacy. You see how shrewd and crafty Rome is to shed the onus of Antichrist away from itself? If you believe in a future Antichrist, a single individual that's going to sign a peace treaty with the Jews and cause animal sacrifices to cease in Jerusalem, in a rebuilt temple, in a rebuilt Jerusalem, the one that God destroyed 2,000 years ago because they rejected him and knew not the time of their visitation. If you believe in that future Antichrist, then you have exonerated the entire office of Antichrist for 2,000 years. How convenient for the papacy. I mean, the futurist belief that is taught in all the churches today is a gold mine for the papacy. He's now free as a bird. Those who condemned the papacy as the Antichrist of the Bible during the Protestant Reformation have been single-handedly defeated by futurism. The entire Protestant Reformation has been now regarded officially by all of Christendom to have been a gross mistake. That the Protestant reformers were in error. The liberation of all of Europe from papal tyranny was a crime against the lawful throne of God on earth, the papacy. The papacy lost all its wealth, it lost all of its influence, it lost all of its power, it lost all of its spiritual power, it lost all of its temporal power. It was nothing in the world after the Protestant Reformation. And now the papacy says, now that you believe in this future Antichrist, you've exonerated me and every pope before me and every pope after me. I hold the office of Christ Almighty on this world, and your Protestant Reformation was a sham. Your Protestant Reformation must be redeemed, and that means that you must restore to me all that you stole from me at the time of the Protestant Reformation. You must restore to me all my temporal power, all my spiritual power, all the land that I commanded and occupied and controlled, all the kings of the earth that you liberated from my rightful throne, my rightful authority. You must make me God on earth. Because that's what I've always claimed to be, the vicar of Christ on earth. And you Protestants in whatever land you live, whether Great Britain or England or the United States or Australia, New Zealand, wherever, your armies must restore to me everything that you liberated from my rightful throne, my rightful authority at the time of the Protestant Reformation. You Protestants who led your rebellion with the belief that the papacy is the Antichrist have now repudiated that belief. And you admit your crime against the papacy. Now you will restore it, or else. And that's the entire function of the United States government today, to help restore militarily, by economic sanction, by foreign diplomacy, by foreign policy, by domestic policy, and every other form of government, is designed to restore to the papacy everything it lost, and then some, not only to reconquer for the papacy what was lost at the time of the Protestant Reformation, but to continue to conquer the rest of the world to the papacy, lands that the papacy never controlled before. What is that? China? Syria? Afghanistan? Iraq? Iran? Saudi Arabia, the whole world. That's facts on the ground, observable today. That's what the United States is doing. The United States of America is nothing but a battle axe for the papacy.
That's true, Tom. Can I refer to the book, The Global Vatican, for a second?
Certainly, that's what we're here to talk about.
There were a few things, I have to look that up for the next time, which I'm going to choose, but this time I'm going to choose page 153. There were a few things that you read that really left an impression on me. I don't know if you have your book by your hand. I have the online version here. So if you want to, you can turn to page 153 and you can, whether say I should start the page before and read the whole stuff or just read the last few words. I mean,
I'll leave that up to you.
I would like to read the whole stuff that starts in the end at the bottom of page 152 on my online version.
Ready to go.
It is The Global Vatican, an inside look at the Catholic Church. Quote, I was sworn in by Secretary Andrew Card, the White House Chief of Staff, at his office in the West Wing. Kathleen, that's the ambassador's wife, and our children could not attend, but Monsignor Girelli from the Holy See's Washington Nunciature, which is the embassy, and my assistant Michael Napolitano were there. Quote, we have a surprise for you, unquote, said Secretary Card after swearing me in. He walked us to the Oval Office. President Bush was at his desk, and he stood to greet us with a warm grin. I told the president that I would represent him to the very best of my abilities. I know you will, he said. That's why I picked you. I first met President George W. Bush in the early 1990s, when our construction company built at the Texas Ranger ballpark for him. The job was a huge opportunity for the company, and we made sure to justify the confidence the future president and his team had placed in us. Now, as his ambassador designate to the Holy See, I had every intention of justifying his confidence again. No president since Ronald Reagan had so truly appreciated, nor been so aligned with, the values of the Holy See as President Bush. Accordingly, I knew that I would have an important advantage in my work, some degree of understanding of what the president would want to accomplish with the mission to the Holy See. A few days after the swearing-in, a package arrived at my office in Tulsa. Inside were my official instructions from President Bush. The letter outlined the duties of an ambassador of the United States in the year 2005. Now, listen very carefully. Quote, our commitment to freedom in America is America's tradition. The advance of freedom is also the surest way to undermine terror and tyranny and to promote peace and prosperity. Your task is to help in advancing this great cause by, first, waging a relentless global war to defeat those who seek to harm us and our friends. And I'm going to stop this quote right here. This sentence that I've just read sent shivers down my spine when I heard you reading that for the first time when you did the reading of the book.
Sure.
Waging a relentless global war. This is word for word taken out of the Jesuit oath of induction.
That's right.
The evil oath the Jesuits have. And to defeat those who seek to harm us and our friends.
Yes. Straight out of the Jesuit oath.
Yeah. This left such an impression on me. But I know I would like you to comment a little bit on what I just read, because there are a few things that you probably want to comment on. That's why I just read it all alone without commenting myself. But, you know, this construction company, when they built the Texas Rangers ballpark for him.
Well, that's a sideline thing. He was a Knight of Malta. The Knights of Malta control entertainment in this country. And entertainment involves, the Coliseums of the United States, the ball diamonds, the football fields, and all that. This Knight of Malta, all these entertainment things are just distractions to keep people pacified, to keep them entertained, so they never discuss any serious matter in this country. I mean, look at the seriousness they put upon a football game. And, of course, it's up to the Jesuit-led Knights of Malta to make sure that these institutions of entertainment keep the people pacified and entertained so they don't discuss matters such as you and I are discussing. The entire entertainment industry, not just football, but the entire entertainment industry is run by the papacy for the purpose of keeping us mindless. Okay, to keep us from reading our Bibles. But what this is out, this is word for word taken out of the Jesuit oath, to make and wage relentless war, secretly and openly, against Protestantism. Now, George W. Bush is speaking to a Knight of Malta. He knows he's going to recognize that phrase. And he knows that Rooney is going to interpret this as having come directly from the Jesuits, that George W. Bush is under the control of the Jesuits and wants to put into practice the Jesuit oath. Now, equally, which is not so evident from what is written here in the book, waging a relentless global war to defeat those who seek to harm us and our friends, who is he talking about?
Who are
is he talking
friends?
About the Muslims? Is he talking about Saddam Hussein? Or is he talking about Protestants? The Jesuit oath is about destroying the Protestant Reformation and about destroying Protestantism or absorbing them back into the Roman Catholic Church.
And destroying
That's
civil
the
liberties.
Global war that they're fighting. And this war, this relentless global war against terror, is just a cover story. True though it may be, a real war, a bloody war, an actual war, a verifiable war that'll never end, its true objective is to destroy Protestantism wherever it exists in the world. Because that's the war that the Jesuits are sworn to fight. And what we get from this war on terror is the destruction of our Protestant rights. What justifies the loss of our Protestant rights in this country is this so-called war on terror. It's just a cover story. Even though it's a real war, it's going on right now as we speak, and Muslims are dying all over the world. That's just the consequential price that should be paid to justify destroying the rights that were won for us from the Protestant Reformation. The real objective is to destroy Protestantism. Because Protestantism is the only thing in this world that is possible to actually inflict harm to the papacy and all the friends of the papacy. The Protestant Reformation is what destroyed the papacy 500 years ago. And it, if it ever wakes up from the delusion called futurism, the belief in a future Antichrist, and now restores the Protestant belief that the papacy is, was, and always will be the Antichrist, as long as the potential exists for the Protestants to ever wake up from that futurist delusion and return to their Protestant beliefs, they are the single greatest threat there is to the restoration of the papal power, and they must be destroyed under whatever disguise you can fashion.
That is also what distincts the Roman Catholic Church from all the other so-called religions in the world.
Yes.
When you take, for example, Hinduism, when you take Buddhism, even when you take Islam, what the Roman Catholic Church is different with them is the Roman Catholic Church has an adversary.
Yes.
That is the true Jesus Christ.
Christ, the true Jesus Christ, the Jesus Christ of the Bible, not the Jesus Christ of the Roman Catholic Church.
No, but Islam doesn't have that kind of adversary. Hinduism doesn't have that kind of adversary. Buddhism doesn't have that kind of adversary. Only the Roman Catholic Church. That's why this fourth empire, this fourth kingdom is so different from all the others. That's
yes.
One of the parts. It's the only one with a real enemy that can defeat him, that will defeat him at the end. That's no question because it's written already. Mm-hmm. But the point is that they are using everyone to defeat them, to harm us, because that means somebody who can harm him, that means that he has an enemy, that he has an adversary.
Yeah.
And that is something that distinguishes the Roman Catholic Church from all the other so-called religions who don't have an adversary.
Yeah.
I think this is a point some people don't even have taken into consideration
What we need to realize is that the Protestants who are the true target of this global war is what is actually being destroyed in the process of conquering the rest of the world for the papacy. Did I make sense?
Yeah.
Who's paying the bill for this global war to conquer the rest of the world for the papacy, the parts of the world that have never been controlled by the papacy? Protestants. At the same time when we're waging this global war to regime change and to conquer for the Pope, Protestants are losing the rights and the liberties whereby Christ has made us free.
We are buying the bullets for our enemy that he shoots us with.
That's right.
We are so stupid.
The world is on a global crusade for the Pope, and who is paying the price? The Protestants.
Yeah, it's like
it is the kingdom of heaven that's being robbed right now to strengthen the papacy, the Antichrist of the Bible.
It's like the sheep going around with a purse making a collection to buy a new slaughterhouse.
Let me tell you something. If there's anything left of the Protestant Reformation after this global war has finally come to fruition, Rome will turn the weapons of the world against us. If there is any Protestant left in this country after we have bled and died to conquer the rest of the world for the Pope, they're going to mop up right here in this country. In any other Protestant country, if there's anyone who protests this Vatican Jesuit-led New World Order, they're going to be destroyed. The Protestant Reformation is the prime target of this global war.
It always has been.
Right now, we are paying the bill, as it was determined at Vatican Council II, when the Protestants repudiated their Protestantism, The papacy says, okay, the papacy now has a political and religious mandate. You Protestants now who have admitted this crime, the Protestant Reformation, are going to conquer the rest of the world for the papacy. You're going to do it with your own blood, your own treasure, your own guts. And if there's anything left of you afterwards, when the world has been conquered at your expense for the papacy, we're going to destroy the last remaining man, woman, and child of you. That's what's coming. And it's not just the Protestants in the United States. It's the Protestants of Europe, Asia, Eurasia, Australia, the whole world. Because Protestantism is the only enemy of Rome that ever succeeded in destroying the papacy's total power, his spiritual and his temporal power, and made him nothing in the world but Antichrist.
I would even go so far to say it's not Protestantism, but it's the Bible and the Bible-believing people.
Certainly, absolutely. Because without the Bible, there never would have been a Protestant Reformation.
The problem, Tom, is, and you know that as good as I do, when today you speak about Protestantism, the problem is there is no protest in the Protestantism churches left anymore.
Certainly, there's
they
no
all,
protest.
They all
there's
adhere
no
to this futurist teaching. Right. So we should... you know, we distinguish Christians. Also, we don't call Catholics Christians because we know that Catholics aren't Christians.
No,
a Christian
not.
Has its first allegiance with Jesus Christ, and a Catholic has its allegiance with the Pope. So
right.
A Catholic can, by definition, not be a Christian, first and for all. Second for all, when you use the word Protestant, okay, you go back into history and you use it historically, that word. That is okay. But what you actually mean, and I just want to make that sure that the listener understands this, when you talk about Protestants, you are actually talking about Bible-believing Christians, people who acknowledge Jesus Christ as their Savior, who acknowledge that Jesus Christ has died for our sins 2,000 years ago at the cross in Calvary. That is what you adhere to when you call Protestants.
When you call yourself a Protestant, you are saying to the world, Christ and Christ alone is my King.
Exactly.
Christ and Christ alone is my Lord. The Bible and the Bible alone is my law. The kingdom of heaven is my inheritance. And the earth is his and the fullness thereof. And the papacy is nothing but a cheap counterfeit.
And a thief.
And has no authority in this world. None. Neither is he a priest nor a pope. He's the man of sin. The son of perdition, the Antichrist of the Bible, and he's to be reviled by the nations of the earth.
Exactly.
And it is Christ who should be restored to his rightful throne. That's what it is to be a Protestant, a Protestant. But here we see all the kingdoms of the world fighting these crusades for the Pope, and nobody tells us what they're all about. Well, the Bible tells us. And we ought to read it, and we ought to understand it like our lives depend upon it, because it literally does. Not just our spiritual life, but our temporal lives as well. Because Rome has every intention of routing us completely off the face of the earth. Rome knows who we are. Rome makes no bones about what her objective is. That was clearly stated at Vatican Council II. It's clearly stated in the Jesuit Oath. It's clearly stated by the doctrines and the encyclicals and the bulls of the popes. They intend to rule this world lock, stock, and barrel, an earthly kingdom that is in contradistinction to the heavenly kingdom of Christ. There is no greater enemy on this earth than the papacy of Jesus Christ. There is no greater enemy of Christ on this world, in this world, than one who seeks to usurp Christ's throne. And that can be found nowhere on the earth but the papacy. There's not even another candidate for Antichrist. And if you believe in a future Antichrist, you have denied the scripture. Not only have you denied that Jesus was the one who caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease 2,000 years ago during the fulfillment of the 70th week of Daniel, but you've exonerated the man of sin and have made him the God of this world. That's the error that has engulfed the entire world. I call futurism the greatest deception since the Garden of Eden. And that's what it is. And if there's any hope for liberty, if there's any hope for Christ, if there's any room for Christ in the world today, it is only if the Protestants remember their Protestant heritage, return to the historical interpretation of the Bible prophecies, understand that it was Jesus who caused the sacrifice and oblations to cease, and any future fulfillment of that by some Antichrist in Jerusalem during the so-called futurist 70th week of Daniel, you just admit you've been deceived. Even the very elect, no matter how much you love Jesus, no matter how much you read your Bible, you have been deceived. Even the very elect of God. And it's time for us to repent. And we don't have much time.
And time for us to wake up, Tom. And I think you did a very good job on reading this Global Vatican. We will go into that in the next broadcast. Thank you very much for being my guest tonight on the show. I want to bring this to a conclusion so we have something to go on next time. And we already have about an hour and a half of recording. And, you know, the attention span of the people most of the time doesn't go much farther than that. So I would like to bring it to an end. Thank you very much for being my guest today on Hour of the Truth, Tom. Is there a short closing remark that you still have? Or even though I found it very nice what you said, but I know that you have a special closing remark normally, so
well,
please.
I always give my blessings in the name of the one who caused the sacrifices and oblations to cease 2,000 years ago. Jesus Christ the righteous, our Lord and King, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. Only he has a throne in this world. Everything else is a counterfeit. He's the one who caused the sacrifice and oblations to cease 2,000 years ago. It is him to whom we owe our allegiance, and him only. See you next time.
That's true. Thank you, Tom. And for our listeners, just for the record, I want to finish with Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle. I had to look it up. Aristotle was the one I was missing.
Yes, indeed.
So thank you. Thank you very much for your attention, and make sure that you will keep an eye on the channel Juggler66, where I will be publishing the videos on Hour of the Truth with Tom Fress, where we will go into another review of the Global Vatican, probably next week or whenever Tom has time and I have the time to find it. But we will give you another review on this great reading that he did, the Global Vatican on the one hand, and we will give you, of course, an outlook into his present work that he does on Inquisition Update, which I will mention next time. So there's something to keep you posted and that you can look up next time. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you very much for watching the video. And until next time, God bless you all, and bye-bye.